A very good afternoon, one and all. It is my great pleasure to welcome you all to the 1 week FDP on Innovative Teaching Approaches organized by Department of Management, BBDITM Lucknow. It is high time that such an event took place to highlight the remarkable contribution under National Education Policy 2020. If I go back and make a glance through the list of presentation done for the previous 3 days, reveals the amazing diversity of the theme, innovative teaching approaches in engineering, management, and technology, and showcases that, yes, there is a great demand and need for innovation in teaching, considering the current scenario. With this, I extend my warm welcome to our eminent resource person, Professor Parul Bhatnagar, ma'am, Associate Professor, Dayalbagh Educational Institute, Dayalbagh, who have come to share her knowledge and expertise with us. I also extend my warm welcome to Chief Patron, Patron, Advisory, and each volunteer. I would also like to pay my deep welcome and respect to all the participants for your positive participation in this FDP. And I wish you all happy learning. With this, I would request our HOD, sir. Sir, please welcome Director, sir, resource person, and all the participants. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sivani. And very good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Manish Singh, Head of the Department of the Department of Management, Babu Banarsidhar Institute of Technology and Management. It is a great honor and privilege for me to welcome all of you on behalf of Department of Management, Babu Banarsidhar Institute of Technology and Management, to this international FDP, Innovative Approaches in Engineering, Technology and Management Teaching. I wish to extend my deepest appreciation to the chief patron. And also I am give my special thanks to patron Professor Dr. Bhavesh Kumar Chauhan, sir, director, Babu Banarsidhar Institute of Technology and Management, Lucknow. And I am delighted to welcome all the participants present today for this international FDP. I warmly welcome to eminent speaker, Professor Parul Bhatnagar, ma'am, Business Incubator Manager, Project Head, Ministry of Textile, and Dayalbagh Education Institute, Dayalbagh, and for her presence. And she is going to discuss a valuable ideas on the topic, Elements of Innovations in Classroom Delivery, Student Engagement, and discussion approaches towards performance-based pay for management teachers. And I also heartily welcome all the participants that they are present today. Thank you for.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to request our director, sir. Sir, please welcome the resource person of the day, Professor Parul Bhatnagar, ma'am. Sir, you are not audible. Sir, kindly.
Thank you, Dr. Shivangi Tiwari, for this honor. And I, on behalf of all the stakeholders, including our chairperson,
sir, you are not audible. There might be some connectivity issue from your side.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. No.
Dr. Shivangi?
No, sir. Not audible, sir.
Not audible. Okay. In fact, I can...
Now fine, sir. Hello? Now fine. Okay. Yes, sir. Fine now.
Okay. Thank you. Sorry for the inconvenience. I, on behalf of the management, and all other stakeholders of the BBD Educational Group, including our chairperson, Srimati Alka Das, and President Viras Sagar Daji, feel honored and privileged to welcome Professor Parul Bhatnagar, who has had such a rich experience when it comes to the textiles and, the designs of the, different, I think her expertise is well known across the Indian, and she has created her footprints, both not only in terms of the academic field, but also in terms of the practical, whether it is exhibitions, whether being awareness of the cross-cultural you know, textile and costumes of the Indian arena. And since the topic is also quite interesting today, regarding not only the different dimensions of teaching, but also the pay scales for the teachers or faculty in management, I'm sure all the audience must be quite excited about the topic and theme also, because that is performance-based evaluation. So yeah, all are really looking forward, and I'm sure so since she is aware about such a vast dimensions of textile and, you know, costumes, which I personally believe they are not restricted to only dresses or, you know, what we wear, but it also has a very, very subtle, you know, interrelation with the living of the individuals and human beings as a society and as a country. So I'm sure this session is going to be quite exciting, and I congratulate the whole organizing team for having requested her. And I also offer a deep sense of gratitude to Professor Parul Bhatnagar that being so busy and also belonging from such a prestigious institute, she kindly accepted our invitation immediately. So, sir, ma'am, really thank you very much well in advance before the session is commencing. And we really look forward for this session. Thank you very much, and congratulations to all organizers once again.
Thank you so much, Director sir. Now I would like to request Aditi Amit to give a formal introduction about our resource person. Aditi, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am, for this opportunity. Good afternoon, everyone. I, Aditi Amit from Department of Management, BBD ITM Lucknow, cordially welcoming you all to day 4 of the 1 week International Faculty Development Program. Now, it is my pleasure and great privilege to welcome our honorable resource person for today's session, Professor Parul Bhatnagar, ma'am. Professor Parul Bhatnagar, ma'am, has wide and various experience in the teaching, research, and management on Indian textiles and customs, organizing textile, exhibitions, designing slavers, also course curriculum for various institutes and universities. Ma'am has extensive documentation of Indian textile besides creating a digital library of designs. Ma'am has studied the traditions and lifestyle of the people of India and has an intimate knowledge as well as grasp of the multifarious diversity of India. Ma'am teaches traditional textiles, design development and management, and also completed a UGC minor research project successfully besides guiding 164 design products. Ma'am, I'm honored to welcome you in our faculty development program, and I would request you to please proceed with the program. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, all of you. I am really happy to be part of your faculty development program at Banarsi for Banarsi Das Institute. I've heard a lot about the engineering and management education. But today, actually, if you look at it, it is not the engineering or management education. With this COVID, what we are all going through, we have to be extremely careful that these going to an excellent institute, studying extremely hard, is not going to take us anywhere. I'm being very blunt, but let me tell you this. Why? With this lockdown, which is happening today in Delhi all over, I don't know about Lucknow, but Agra, we are having lockdown overnight. What is going to happen? People are going to lose jobs. So don't you think whatever we are trying to teach in the educational institutions, it has to be that we are not job seekers, but we become job enablers. This is exactly what our new educational policy is working on. Dayalbagh Educational Institute, this kind of education started here in 1917. That is more than 100 years old. And we started our education making our students job enablers, which we all institutions around the country have to work up now. This is going to be my first part of presentation. I'm dividing my presentation in three parts, and I'm telling you all the three parts, and then we'll go ahead with it. The second part is going to be about, you asked me about pay scales. When I'm talking about pay scales, I personally feel the salaries which we all get and the kind of salaries we get are crazily hell of a lot. I mean, it should not be really that much. We are actually being stooges to the government of India. Why? You know the way your salaries should work out? The assistant professors, they start off. The first salary they take home is around 87,000 rupees. Associate professors, they take home around 1.5. Professors, they take home 10, 2 plus. Well, these are the kind of salaries I'm talking about at Dayalbagh Educational Institute. But what is attached with them? The professors have to have projects. Associate professors also have to have projects. They have to have research papers. Only then they can get those kind of salaries. Not the way we are working on. At present, I'm a retired woman. I retired 3 years back from DEI. I have 12 projects under my belt, which are being run, funded by Government of India. Ministry of Textiles, we have 12 projects on traditional crafts, which are being run at 340 centers around the country. Here we are training students into different crafts to be and start their own SHGs, to have their own skill-based teaching. And in the final session, that will be the third part of my presentation, I am going to talk how in an educational institute, especially yours, which is teaching you management and as well as technology, being in an engineering institution, how you are going to have it that alongside with your education, alongside with your teaching theoretical subjects, practical aspect would also be there. For that, there is something known as verb-based training. Jo bhi hum log seekhenge, theoretical papers ya theoretical subjects ke andar, wo ek work-based training hogi. I'm going to show you how this is going to happen. And this is exactly what Dayalbagh Educational Institute is doing. Whether it is management, in management, generally we talk about finance, we talk about HR, okay? If you go into the engineering, we talk about civil engineering, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering. But do you think we ever talk about that these engineering subjects or these management subjects should be connected to arts? Which is, or music, in arts you talk about music, drawing and painting. Do we ever talk about that? I'm going to show you that in the third part of my presentation. So without, I don't know, wasting more time or getting here and there, let me just quickly go back to my presentation. I will share my screen with you. And when you can see it, please tell me, please raise your hand. Shivani?
Yes, ma'am. It's visible.
Is it absolutely clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fantastic. So today we are talking about elements of innovations in classroom delivery, students' engagement and discussions approaches towards performance-based pay for these people. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, okay. So in my next slide, here you can see that the students whom you see here are all from different streams. When I talk about management, or when I talk about engineering, when I talk about commerce, because if we have to start our own work, it is extremely important that all these things are together. We work on them together, we deliver together, we accept together. And today, the most challenged people are our village lot. Here you can see. We also work with, there is a village by the name of Raja Barari in Madhya Pradesh in Hoshangabad district, where we also have two projects running. And there we are training these scheduled tribe people. Then you talk about Mela Thiruvenkatanathapuram, way down in south. There again, we are doing the same. Plus, we have a lot of villages in Lucknow, whether you talk about it in Agra or F. So what we do is we have these medical camps. Now, I'm basically trying to tell you how we are going to gel these things together. We have these medical camps, and what do we do in these medical camps? All of us go there every Sunday. We get the villagers over. Incidentally, Dayalbagh Educational Institute also has a medical college or a medical school. But here we are not dealing with these medicines which we generally talk about, but we are talking or dealing with Ayurvedic medicines, homeopathic medicines. We have the yoga. So we are a very traditional university. And in these, jo hamara guru shishya parampara thi, wo aap actually Dayalbagh mein dekh sakte hain. You all are most welcome to come and visit. My www.di.ac.in is our website. You can visit that. You can reach me at parul@di.ac.in and come and see it for yourself. But just seeing will not make any difference. If tomorrow you go back to your Banarsidas Institute and you get a couple of projects and you give those projects to your university, then there is any point of coming to Dayalbagh and seeing those things and learning those things. You know, in this second photograph, in the first is the medical camp where free medicines are given, where the people are taught how to make food, different types of foods, and you know how to preserve them. In the second photograph, you can see the management or the engineering or the medical school or the commerce, our education faculty, arts faculty, working with their own hands on agriculture, growing produce. In the third pic, you can see the women of Raja Barari learning the skills of block printing. Or this is one of our students, you know, they go there and they teach them weaving. Here you can see our automobile engineering students working on, you know, we have a tie-up with Yamaha, we have a tie-up with Suzuki, we have tie-up with the TVS. And a minute the student takes admission into the institute, students are accepted by these places, these institutes, various industries, and the entire batch is taken away by them, because in the 4 years they spent at DI, they have learned the skills. They have learned the exceptional skills of working with their own hands or soiling their own hands. Generally, what the students, if an engineering graduate comes out, you know, if you ask him even to change a fuse or a bulb, sorry to say that my lovely students were, I mean, your all your students, they will not be able to do it. Seriously, they will not be able to change a fuse or do a bulb. But if you tell a technical student to do that, he will be able to do those skills because he has learned how to soil his own hands and deliver. In this particular picture, you can see the engineering student girls working at arts faculty, trying to develop or trying to use their innovative, creative styles of working. If your creativity is there, you can be excellent AI graduates. Let me tell you that. Here the students are working to have food and all sorts of things. And this is a particular vehicle which has been again designed by our students. This is totally battery operated. In Dayalbagh, petrol vehicles, or if you talk about diesel vehicles, are not allowed. Totally, it's eco-friendly. We have solar. I'll be working on that a little later. So what does innovation in education is? It is a moral, spiritual values, etiquettes, ethics. For that, we have to develop intuitive consciousness. If we develop intuitive consciousness, we exactly would know or can create a lot of things. This nurtures creativity and imagination. Modern techniques and technologies exist. Keeping our traditions, qualities, and values are the key of our education. If we don't have the quality, if we don't have the value, what will happen to this education? This is what all our various professors who are sitting need to realize. To evolve the next generation students, innovation are the core futuristic skills. Now, when I talk about the core futuristic skills, what do I mean? We talk about the superhuman being, super intelligence, super consciousness. We talk about the six S's. We are talking about reaching and mobilizing the last, the least, the lowest, and the lost among mankind. We are talking about enabling self-employment through nano enterprises. I don't expect you all people to think about it that today you come out of the institute and you have a big organization. No way. We all have to start young. We all have to start as freshers. And one of the reasons how we have to start that is that in your institute, I believe your director, sir, must be also listening. And the people who are doing your curriculum also must be listening. You need to have at least 1 year of co-op training. Now, what is that co-op training? In that particular co-op training, you will be going and working in various industries. Now, here you're going to tell me, madam, at one end, you say we have to become job enablers and not job seekers. And at the other end, you say you go and work in the industry. Yes, absolutely correct. You have to work in an industry for a year during your course of study. Like even today, all our institutes, all our universities, all our schools, colleges around the country are all closed under the lockdown. But we are teaching, we are having our lectures from home. And believe it or not, studying, listening, teaching from the vicinity, from the comfort of a house is far, far more productive than going to the institute. Being at the institute, we are able, we'll be spending a lot of time when we are at the institute with our friends, our peer, and wasting a lot of time. Whereas if we are sitting at home, and if we are focused, we will be working for, we will be taking the lessons, whether they are through Zoom or through their Google Hangouts or Google Classroom or whatever media you want to work on. At the same time, we'll have enough time to work for our projects, write projects, share them online, have innovative style of learning. Now, what are these resource centers I'm talking about? We have to develop these resource centers. Each institute, each organization has to have these resource centers. And when we talk about these resource centers, aap logon ne colleges, universities mein naukriyan to li, par jab tak aapka institute ek incubation center nahi hai, तो उस इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज का, उस मैनेजमेंट स्कूल का कोई फायदा नहीं है. यू ऑल द होल लॉट ऑफ प्रोफेसर्स, ऑल्दो आई एम गोइंग टू बी अगेंस्ट वट एवर आई एम स्पीकिंग, आई एम श्योर यू मस्ट बी ट्राइंग टू पुल माई हेयर आउट, बट इट इज अ फैक्ट दैट यू पीपल आर ऑल वेस्टिंग योर टाइम. If in your institute you do not have a resource center, an incubation center, where you do not send your students for 1 year of co-op training, 6 months at a time, where you are not able to present at least 2 international and 4 national research papers to your institute every year, if you are not able to get at least a project every second year, you all are wasting your time, effort, everything. How do we work on these resource centers? To finance the setting up of state or national level technical resource centers, we have to provide infrastructure and professional support, which is done by the institute in training, in capacity, awareness building. How do we get there? Qualities with value for sustainable future is the way of life to make us realize our potential with dignity. Innovations and value-based education, AI, Internet of Things, IoT, those are the buzzwords today. We talk about renewable energy or automobile. Again, those are the buzzwords for the technocrats. When we talk about the management people, we should talk about the dairy technology, agricultural technology, food processing and preservation technologies. Because these are the these are the centers which is going to take you for your management, like for your financial management, agar aap log kar rahe ho, ya aap HR kar rahe ho. But supposing you are dealing in the arts, the commerce, then you are dealing with the apparel design, you're talking about textiles, you're talking about music, you're talking about water sanitation, you're talking about solid waste management. Then what are these innovations in the skill development with research? Now, the things which I just told you about, how are you going to get there with research? When we talk about getting there by research, to provide free, seamless education from preschool to secondary level to higher education. Here we talk about knowledge, skills, and abilities. Everybody is not born with knowledge. Everybody is not born with skills. Everybody is not born with various abilities. But we can definitely, through innovations and creativity, develop them and enhance them. We have to study the correlation between the underperformance and the deprivation. Now, what are we going to be talking about? How are we going to make this sustainable? How are we going to recognize that every child is unique and there are limits to generic solutions? Everybody's parents are not doctors, engineers, management gurus, but everybody's parents, in one way or the other, are successful. We have to learn to be positive. We have to learn that what are we going to do? हम लोगों के अंदर एक डर सा बैठ गया है, especially the people who are losing their jobs and all. वो डर कैसा है? वो डर कि मुझे कुछ नहीं आता है. वो ऐसा डर इसलिए है कि मेरी जो एजुकेशन हुई थी वो आधी अधूरी रह गई थी. आप लोगों को, यू ऑल आर प्रोफेसर्स, आप लोगों को ये देखना है कि आप लोग अपने स्टूडेंट्स को जो पढ़ाएं उनके अंदर ये डर ना आ जाए कि मेरी एजुकेशन जो है या जो मुझे मिली BDS यूनिवर्सिटी से वो आधी अधूरी रह गई. दे शुड कम बैक एंड से वेल दे आर द बेस्ट. They taught me how to soil my own hands. They taught me to put up these super lovely industries. They were the people who taught me the equal right gender. Hum logon mein aaya. Vocational skills develop courses are attached with every higher education to bring out the potential of research in entrepreneurial activities. So in a way, you all have to develop your students to become entrepreneurs. The income generating from an entrepreneurial activity will always produce excellent skill development and livelihood. They will never be negative. And how are we going to really look into it? At Dayalbagh Educational Institute, we have an excellent database of our alumni. And that alumni really helps our students in developing their skills and even selling their stuff. Being an educational institution, we people cannot do anything for profit. But what we can do is, we can, while we are studying, we can nurture our skills for development of our skills. We can nurture our skills in development of various entrepreneurial activities. Center for Research, Technical Training and Skill Development is at your institute. I'm 100% sure if your university professors, I mean, all of you, if you get together, hold your hands, like they always say, na? Hamara haath, hamare haath mein paanch ungliyan hain. Agar ye alag alag rahengi, to humko, we will not be able to do justice. But if we fold them into a fist, we are a strong community. So your BDS is going to become an excellently strong community. The developed methodology, techniques and tools to study and deliver the social sector schemes. That is extremely important, the social sector schemes. You all have to look in and see about those social sector schemes. Aajkal kya ho raha hai? A lot of people, unko COVID koi positive ho raha hai. एक बारी 8 दिन के अंदर आप 3 बारी एक आई नो ऑफ पर्टिकुलर पर्सन वन ऑफ द आई नो वन ऑफ द पर्सन वन ऑफ माई फ्रेंड्स. सो व्हाट हैपेंड वाज इन 8 डेज ही गॉट हिमसेल्फ टेस्टेड थ्राइस. 2 बारी वो पॉजिटिव आया, 1 बारी वो नेगेटिव आया. जब वो पॉजिटिव आया था तो वो घर पे रहा, जब वो नेगेटिव आया तो वो ऑफिस चला गया, फिर पॉजिटिव आया फिर घर बैठ गया. बट एक्चुअली ही वॉज कैरिंग. सो उसने सोशल ये नहीं सोचा कि मैं 15 दिन घर बैठ जाऊं. तो जिस प्रकार ये कोविड स्प्रेड हो रहा है ना, अगर हम लोग इन सोशल सेक्टर स्कीम्स में अगर हम लोग हाथ डालें, इसको समझना सीखें, इस पे डेवलप करें, तो जिस प्रकार ये कोविड बढ़ रहा है ना, इसी प्रकार आपकी ये डिफरेंट डिफरेंट स्कीम्स ही बढ़ेंगी एंड यू विल बी एक्सट्रीमली सक्सेसफुल. वी हैव टू प्रोवाइड द यूथ विद स्किल्स एंड ट्रेनिंग अपॉर्चुनिटीज सो एज टू अंडरस्टैंड दीज सोशल रियालिटीज ऑफ लाइफ which a lot of us are not understanding today. The problem stands with us. What are the strengths of an educationist? The strengths of an educationist is to have passion, motivation, and dedication. Faculty with passion, motivation, dedication, hard work, team spirit, cooperative, and open-mindedness can make a huge difference. Uplifting of tribals and downtrodden by teaching skills through DI's outreach centers, which is 340 we have. I don't know, you can all join hands with our educational system. In fact, in Lucknow also, we have one of our outreach centers. Now, if we work that, we can have excellent opportunities for placements. But now we don't believe in that. But aaj ke roz jitne students universities mein colleges mein ja rahe hain, unko to naukriyan chahiye. To ye main aapko purana tarika batati hu jo Dayalbagh educational institution kar raha tha pehle. Hum logon ke job fairs hote the, co-op programs hote the, guest lectures hote the. We used to invite people from industry. We used to also have institute partnership. Earn while you learn scheme was extremely important. Entrepreneurial activities ensured job enablers. Then job seekers, which I'm talking about. The alumni association network, which ensures placement, is excellent. You also have to have an alumni association. Mid-semester training helps to mold students as per the industrial norms. So when we talk about these co-op trainings, these are the mid-semester. Agar hum log engineering mein jate hain, to hum log ye jo 2 mahine ki jo garmiyon ki chuttiyan hoti hain, ye log hum log we waste a lot of time. But I would suggest, instead of wasting that time, if we go in for training, that would be a great benefit to all of us. Our syllabi are should be such curriculum that training should be there in first year, second year, third year, fourth year. Besides having training in 4 years, two semesters are must in the industry. Co-op training, where you will be working under a supervised personality, and then later on, if you work well, I'm sure you will get excellent jobs. Now I'm going to quickly run through. I think, I hope I have not exceeded my time, ma'am.
No, ma'am, you can take your time.
No, I won't take my time. I know. 1 ghante ka time hai, 54 minute ho chuke hain. Okay, now this is agricultural technology, dairy technology. Now here I am sharing what is being done at Dayalbagh University. We have the best of infrastructure and we let the students whatever they want to. Now this is Adina. Sorry. This is Adina. This is agricultural and dairy nano processing of multi products. This is being done, and everything what I'm talking about is being sold also. Here the students are working on the next generation of the automobile. We are also developing. We have got the first electrical tractor, which was made by Escorts. Our students are working on making electrical vehicles. These are, of course, battery operated vehicles. Here you will see that how our university, our entire university has these solar panels. We don't hire people from outside to take care of these solar panels, but the students work on it and they earn pocket money. Hamari university mein ek agar aap any of the BVO courses karte hain to 2800 rupaye ek semester ki fees hai. Agar aap engineering karte hain to 10000 ki fees hai jo 40000 rupaye mein aap ek pure engineer ban jate hain. Hamari university 100% funded hai. Government of India se, UGC se, we all get our salaries from there. And here you can see it is 100%. We have students can. Aajkal to khair hostels band hai, university hi band hai aajkal to, but classes chal rahi hain. But you can see the kitchens and the hostels around Dayalbagh and the villages. Dayalbagh itni zyada bijli bana raha hai ki iske charon taraf jitne gaon hain, un sabko hum log bijli free of cost de rahe hain. Dayalbagh ek rupya bhi bijli pe kharcha nahi kar raha, sab solar pe kaam ho raha hai. Hamare paas World Bank funding se France ka ek project hai jiske andar, mere paas aaj picture nahi hai uski, I wish I had that picture, I would have shown you. We have huge panels which have been erected in between our farms. और ऊपर उसके solar panels हैं और नीचे से जितने भी आपके machineries होती हैं, ये उन सब solar panels से इसको charge करते हैं. और even tractors वगैरह जितने भी हैं, हमारे harvesters हैं, सब कुछ solar से चलता है. आजकल thresher पे काम हो रहा था, वो भी solar से चलता है. ये देखिए आप, again you can see our students working. So what I'm trying to tell you is that my dear professors, you have to work up, get the students to be working if you want your university to be as great as Dayalbagh Educational. We are A++ university, we are ISO certified, we are, you name it and we have it. We have umpteen number of MOUs with huge lot of countries around the world. Again here, zaruri nahi hai ki ladkiyan ladke hi kare ye sab kaam, ye sab ladkiyan bhi karti hain. And here you can see hamara engineering se ye ladkiyan sab engineering ki ladkiyan hain. ये कुछ ऐसे स्टूडेंट्स हैं जिनको शेड्यूल ट्राइब और शेड्यूल कास्ट की लड़कियां हैं. हमारे जो मैंने आपको बताया 12 प्रोजेक्ट्स हैं, वो मैं आपको आगे दिखाऊंगी. इन 12 प्रोजेक्ट्स में ये सब बच्चे जो हैं, जो आप देख रहे हैं, दे आर नॉट एजुकेटेड, आठवीं पास भी नहीं है. पर हम इन बच्चों को थ्रू आर मैनेजमेंट एंड आर commerce students, our arts students, we train these people. The arts people, they train them into their designing skills. The management people, they train them marketing kaise karni hai, financials kaise karne hai. Commerce ke students in logon ko sikhate hain ki costing kaise karni hai humko apne products ki. और हियर आप देख सकते हैं कि किस प्रकार आसपास की विलेज के लोगों को सिखाया जा रहा है. अगर हम लोग यंग बच्चों को काम करना सिखाएं तो ऐसी कोई भी कम्युनिटी नहीं है, ऐसा कुछ भी नहीं है कि हम लोग ना सीख पाए. इसीलिए दयालबाग के अंदर 3 हफ्ते से हम लोग ट्रेनिंग को शुरू कर देते हैं. ये कुछ प्रोडक्ट्स हैं जो आप लोग देख रहे हैं विच हैव बीन मेड बाय आवर स्टूडेंट्स एंड दे आर बीइंग एक्सपोर्टेड टू फ्रांस. हमारी जितना भी हमारा करिकुलम है वो सब ई कंटेंट में ट्रांसफॉर्म्ड है. वेदर इट इज कॉमर्स, इट इज इंजीनियरिंग, इट इज आर्ट्स, साइंस, आप कोई भी सब्जेक्ट लीजिए. एंड वेल द बुक्स व्हाट आई एम शोइंग यू आर ऑफ टेक्सटाइल्स, इंग्लिश, हिंदी, तमिल, तेलुगु में ये सब ट्रांसलेटेड है. स्टूडेंट को कॉलेज आने की कोई आवश्यकता नहीं है. इन इस पेंडेमिक के वक्त दे ऑल आर हैविंग दीज बुक्स एंड दे आर यूटिलाइजिंग देम. हमारे जो एक्सटेंशन एंड आउटरीच वर्क एट राजा बरारी है, द फ्री मेडिकल कैंप और रूरल असिस्टेंस कैंप, यू कैन सी. एंड आई टेल यू समथिंग, द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ राजा बरारी और मेलाथर वेंकटनाथपुरम, दिस पर्टिकुलर फोटोग्राफ इज फ्रॉम देयर, द स्टूडेंट्स देयर, देयर डिजाइनिंग इज अमेजिंग. वी हैड स्टूडेंट्स फ्रॉम हांगकॉन्ग यूनिवर्सिटी and they were totally berserk when they saw the kind of work they were doing, because in logon ke dimag jo hai wo hamare shaharon ki tarah kharab nahi ho gaye hain. Let me tell you that hum log bahar ke deshon ko dekhte hain par asal cheez to hamare desh mein hai. Why do we think, why do we work on seeing what is there abroad? We should think and work हमारे पास क्या है. हाउ कैन वी बी द रूलर्स ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. वो दिन दूर नहीं जिस दिन ऐसा होगा. अभी वेरी रिसेंटली अब तो 2-3 साल हो गए, दयालबाग यूनिवर्सिटी ऑल्सो वी वर गिवन दिस स्वच्छ भारत. वी वर रैंक नंबर 1 इन द कंट्री for the most cleanest of the universities. Here, okay, I'm now sharing the various projects being, these are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 projects hain, but isme 8 hain, but mere paas is samay 12 chal rahe hain. Aur in 12 projects mein jo ye chal rahe hain, ye sab traditional hain, agar aap log dhyan se dekhen. So they all are traditional. And aap ye can इमेजिन आप लोग कर सकते हो कि जब एक फैकल्टी मेंबर के पास, वेल आई एम एमेरिटस प्रोफेसर, एक जने के पास अगर 12 प्रोजेक्ट्स हैं तो पूरी यूनिवर्सिटी का क्या हाल होगा. यू कैन थिंक अबाउट इट. हमको फंडिंग मिले चाहे ना मिले, नोबडी कैन स्टॉप अस. पीछे से अभी लेटली फीस नहीं आ रही थी, सॉरी वो नहीं आ रही थी, सैलरीज नहीं आ रही थी. It did not deter us because हम लोग को जो हमारी कमाई सैलरीज में तो हो ही रही है. अरे that is just one part of it. जो हम लोगों की, everybody is a big reader. If you even google down today Parul Bhatnagar, आप google करो तो you will see umpteen number of books on Amazon. मेरा ही नहीं, सबका आप देखिए कितनी बुक्स हैं. उसकी जो रॉयल्टी मनी आती है वो ही इतनी है कि आपको सैलरी की जरूरत ही नहीं है. यू डोंट द मनी, यू डोंट हैव टू रन बिहाइंड द मनी. लेट मी टेल यू ऑल प्रोफेसर्स, द मनी इज गोइंग टू रन बिहाइंड यू. इसको कहते हैं ना, टू मेक द फर्स्ट मिलियन इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट, बट टू मेक द सब्सिक्वेंट मिलियन इट्स एक्सट्रीमली ईजी. हियर यू कैन सी आवर इंटरनेशनल एक्सचेंज प्रोग्राम्स. वेल पिछले साल नहीं हुआ और इस साल नहीं हुआ बिकॉज ऑफ पेंडेमिक, बट हर साल गर्मियों की छुट्टियों में दयालबाग यूनिवर्सिटी के स्टूडेंट्स हांगकॉन्ग यूनिवर्सिटी जाते हैं और हर साल विंटर्स में हांगकॉन्ग यूनिवर्सिटी के स्टूडेंट्स दयालबाग आते हैं. यहाँ पे जब वो लोग आते हैं, चीज़ें सीख के जाते हैं एंड देन दे मेक देम देयर एंड दे सेल. दिस इज आवर 100% सस्टेनेबल मॉडल. वी कॉल इट Sigma 6QVA, quality with value and attributes for a sustainable future. So my young friends, that was it. I hope you are not ज़्यादा बोर तो नहीं हुए आप लोग. अगर होए हो तो आई एम सॉरी, एक घंटा मैंने आपका बर्बाद कर दिया. बट अगर नहीं तो आई एम ओपन फॉर क्वेश्चंस इफ यू वांट टू आस्क. यस,
थैंक यू सो मच मैम फॉर सच अ वंडरफुल डेलिबरेशन. पार्टिसिपेंट, इफ यू वांट टू आस्क समथिंग, यू कैन सिंपली पुट योर क्वेरी इन अ चैट बॉक्स और यू कैन डायरेक्टली आस्क टू मैम.
आई थिंक इट विल बी ग्रेट इफ दे कैन आस्क मी सो आई कैन आंसर देम एएसएपी. And here I'm just reading one of the participants. He's spoken that he is a life member of Systems Society of India. That's excellent, Virat. We just had the program last Sunday. I hope, not this Sunday, previous to that. I hope, Virat, you attended that Systems Society program. If Virat is there. We have a lot of publications which a lot of people have spoken about. I'm just going through your various chats if there are any questions. But
actually, we are not provided any information regarding the events organized by SSI. I had also complained to its officials, but there was a very little response from their side.
Oh, Virat, I'm extremely sorry for this. But I will tell the secretary of SSI about it. I also happen to be the life member, and I'm really passionate about Systems Society of India. And incidentally, a previous director, vice chancellor, who is also now the guru. Well, Dayalbagh Educational Institute is by the Radha Swamis, you know, Radha Swami of Dayalbagh, okay? And jo hamare guru hai, Professor Prem Saran Satsangi, inhone Systems Society ka jo movement tha, wo 1994 mein shuru kiya tha, jab ve IIT Delhi mein professor the, he was the dean there. He's an electrical engineer. Tab unhone yes shuru kiya tha. Jo aaj it is doing amazingly well and it is doing an amazing job. Yes, Virat. I'll see to it that this happens and you are told about it. Abhi ek, incidentally, you people can all join up. If I'm not connected to your WhatsApp group, if I'm connected to your WhatsApp group, I can always put in a thing. Jab hamara, we have also Dayalbagh Science of Consciousness.
The SSI website is also outdated. It has no information regarding the various events and there is no connection to the...
Sir, aap mujhe ye zara mail dal sakte ho? Aapki jo bhi problems hai na, parul@di.ac.in par aapko jo bhi problems hai aap daliye. And I'll see to it aapki sari problems solve out ho jayengi.
Can you please share your email address in the chat box, ma'am?
Yes, sure, definitely.
Thank you very much.
Write it. Yeah.
Hello, good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Am I audible?
Yeah, very nice. Perfect. Tell me.
Yes, madam, this is Hassan. I'm calling from Bangladesh.
Oh, wow.
It was really insightful presentations. I'm really so grateful to you. So thank you so much. So I learned a lot of things from you today, madam. Thank you so much.
Sir, you don't have to be grateful to me, but thoda sa, if you can work out on this, you have to change the way of looking. You have to change the way of education system. Ye jo hamara new education policy aayi hai India mein, ये बहुत ही बढ़िया एजुकेशन पॉलिसी है और आपको इसके तहत इफ यू वर्क ऑन इट यू हैव टू सी टू इट दैट यू हैव टू मेक द एजुकेशन मीनिंगफुल. आज के रोज एक स्टूडेंट अपना आई कॉल इट डंकी लोड यू नो कंधे पे रख के लेके जाता है आगे और वो जब जाता है आगे तो उसको ये नहीं पता उसके बैग में कितनी किताबें हैं कितना वो उसके दिमाग में जा रहा है. टू टेल यू वेरी फ्रेंकली उसके दिमाग में कुछ नहीं जा रहा वो क्योंकि उसके माँ बाप कहते हैं उसको दसवीं करनी है उसको बारहवीं करनी है फिर उसको कॉलेज जरूर जाना है. मेरे हिसाब से कोई जरूरी नहीं. क्या बिल गेट्स किसी कॉलेज गया था? ही वाज अ ड्रॉप आउट. if you talk about the various huge inventors and things, क्या उनको कुछ पता था? कुछ नहीं. तो क्यों नहीं हम लोग अपनी एजुकेशन ऐसी बनाएं कि ये सब हम लोग अपने स्टूडेंट्स को दें? क्योंकि आप सब प्रोफेसर्स हैं, सब इतने पढ़े लिखे लोग हैं, इसलिए मैं कह रही हूँ, प्लीज मेक योर एजुकेशन, गिव योर एजुकेशन इन सच अ वे दैट इट ऑल हेल्प्स योर स्टूडेंट्स. ओके, प्लीज ट्राई टू गेट प्रोजेक्ट्स. गवर्नमेंट के पास दोनों हाथ खोलकर प्रोजेक्ट्स रखे हुए हैं इस समय. आप देखिए कि आप लोग क्या कर सकते हैं. घर में मत बैठिए खाली. वी ऑल हैव टन्स ऑफ टाइम विद अस. प्लीज लुक इनटू इट एंड मूव फॉरवर्ड. यस, नेक्स्ट. इफ एनीबडी इज इंटरेस्टेड,
गुड आफ्टरनून
मैम. वी कैन से मैडम, देन वी कैन से चेंज आवर थॉट्स, चेंज द वर्ल्ड.
यस, एब्सोल्युटली करेक्ट सर. So it was a pleasure talking to you. Well, I'm in India and you're in Bangladesh. It's present. It was.
Yeah, my name is Hassan.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So you have my email ID. I'm always there. You can always connect with me and we can always move forward. My
sure.
My WhatsApp number, I'm also put in there.
Thank you.
I have also put in my WhatsApp number. It is there and you can always WhatsApp me. I prefer talking on mail or WhatsApp instead of calls because I happen to be busy in a lot of things. 12 projects is not an easy thing, okay? Let me tell you, but it's fun. Okay, tell me, ask me anything else.
Anyone? Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Dr. Subba Rao.
Yes, sir.
I want to know about the interdisciplinarity component of curriculum in your university. And one more thing I want to know is about the interdepartmental communication and collaboration within the institute, because you're working on creativity and innovation. So I think it will be much more in your university. Want to know about that.
Absolutely. So in the beginning, I told you about that we have something known as work experience. An engineering graduate, he comes to arts faculty and he learns commercial art. He learns music. An art student, a textile student, goes to the electrical department in engineering university college and learns, you know, she learns screen printing here. Jo aap log chip design karte hain, which is nothing else, but uske jo circuit boards hote hain, those are all screen printed. You all are aware of it. तो ये जो सर्किट बोर्ड्स हैं, इनकी जो प्रिंटिंग होती है, ये हमारे जो आर्ट्स फैकल्टी में जो टेक्सटाइल की स्टूडेंट्स हैं या एपरल की जो स्टूडेंट्स हैं, ये लोग जाके करते हैं. ये लोग जाके सीखते हैं कि किस प्रकार खाली हमको इसका सर्किट बोर्ड को प्रिंटिंग करना नहीं सीखना, बट ऑल्सो इसके जो नोड्स होते हैं, इसके और चीजें होती हैं, वो कैसे ऐड करना है, कैसे करना है. इसके लिए बहुत जरूरी होता है कि जो हमारी फैकल्टी होती है वो एक जो एक तो हमारा जो करिकुलम होता है वो ऐसा होता है कि इंजीनियरिंग के जो सब्जेक्ट्स होते हैं उसके अंदर देयर इज समथिंग नोन एज हाफ कोर्सेज एंड आल्सो देयर इज समथिंग नोन एज वर्क एक्सपीरियंस कोर्सेज. वर्क एक्सपीरियंस कोर्सेज वो कोर्सेज होते हैं जो हमारे डायरेक्ट कोर्स करिकुलम से अटैच हों. जैसे अगर कोई इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग कर रहा है तो वो वर्क एक्सपीरियंस के दो हर सेमेस्टर में एक कोर्स लेगा और 4 इसके कोर्सेज होंगे, मतलब 2 साल तक वो लेगा और हर सेमेस्टर में उसका एक डिफरेंट वर्क एक्सपीरियंस होगा. माने तो अगर एक इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियर और उसमें से 2 उसके जो कोर्सेज होंगे वो होंगे फैकल्टी कोर्सेज और 2 होंगे नॉन फैकल्टी कोर्सेज. फैकल्टी
क्रॉस फंक्शनल
या फैकल्टी को और फिर दूसरा उसका होगा ही विल बी हैविंग हाफ कोर्सेज. Now, half courses is of half a credit. Jo, ours is a credit-based system. Jo aapka work experience course hoga, that is going to be 2 credits each. The credits are defined by the number of lectures, classes, practicals you have. Is that, you see, it's a huge thing, but have you been able to figure it out? Have you been able to understand?
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. Anybody else? Anything else? बहुत हो गया, सबको भूख लग रही है या खाना पीना खा लिया? खाना खा लिया या खाना है? क्या बहुत हो गया बंद करना है टेल मी एनी क्वेश्चन
आई गेस दे आर वेरी मच सेटिस्फाइड विद योर सेशन मैम दे डोंट हैव एनी काइंड ऑफ डाउट
यू नो जब आप ऐसा चीज कहते हो ना दे आर वेरी मच विद योर सेशन एंड दे डोंट हैव एनी डाउट्स या तो इट वाज लाइक एन एम्प्टी बकेट आप उसके ऊपर हम पानी भरते गए राइट या तो ऐसा हुआ या ऐसा हुआ कि यू आर रियली सेटिस्फाइड अब मुझे नहीं पता क्या हुआ क्या नहीं हुआ बट आई एम हैप्पी दैट यू पीपल एंजॉयड द सेशन एंड आई होप समथिंग हैज गॉन इनसाइड
Ma'am, two questions are there in the chat box also, please.
What is it? Ma'am, can you give me name on places where we can get some projects in computer science? Yes, sir, absolutely. Sir, please go to the website. IT, Ministry of Electronics. Sir, is samay Ministry of Electronics is... Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Ministry of Electronics जो है इस समय
okay, ma'am.
एक दो लाख के नहीं करोड़ों के प्रोजेक्ट देने को तैयार है एंड ये what they want is कि जो चाइना में हो रहा है they want that कि it should be India. Okay? They have offered Dayalbagh couple of crores, 20 crores I was offered last year. But मेरे पास इतने और प्रोजेक्ट्स हैं that I was not able to take it. So I have given it to some other people in my institute. But you please visit them and उनकी वेबसाइट पे चले जाइए and you will get a lot of projects there. Alright? So ये सब आपको कंप्यूटर साइंस में ही रिलेटेड हैं and also कंप्यूटर साइंस एक I would say एक जमाना था जब कंप्यूटर साइंस was known as the जिसको कहते हैं ना the buzzword. ऐसा नहीं है आज के रोज हर सब्जेक्ट के अंदर कंप्यूटर है अगर आपको कंप्यूटर नहीं आता तो आप जीरो हैं आप सबको कंप्यूटर सीखना है ओके नाउ व्हाट इज द सेकंड क्वेश्चन व्हाट इज द प्रोसेस ऑफ गेटिंग गवर्नमेंट प्रोजेक्ट्स इट्स वेरी सिंपल यू आजकल तो सब कुछ ऑनलाइन हो गया है यू जस्ट हैव टू राइट अ प्रोजेक्ट डाउनलोड फ्रॉम द वेबसाइट द वेरियस प्रोजेक्ट्स एमएसएमई इज गिविंग हंड्रेड्स ऑफ प्रोजेक्ट्स You can also become an incubator for. Are you people an incubator for MSME, ma'am?
No, no, ma'am. Right? No, no.
But why not? आपकी strength कितनी है professors की आपकी institute में?
Around sir 200.
200 है. तो 200 is a great number यार. तो 200 है तो at least well Dayalbagh is a business incubator for MSME. And also we have got umpteen number of projects from them and the people have been funded and we have moved forward. Why don't you people apply?
Ma'am,
but आप लोग कभी apply कर सकते हो जब आपके professors जो हैं वो कुछ सोचें positive तरीके से और आगे काम करना शुरू करें. अभी मेरे से विराट ने ही मेरे ख्याल पूछा था कि computer science के बारे में project मुझे कहाँ मिल सकता है ना विराट? Project में तुम करना क्या चाहते हो? Can I know that? What do you mean by project? देखो, you are also a research scholar, I believe. है ना? Yes, Virat?
Virat, sir, you there?
Are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Anyway, I have not asked regarding the computer science, ma'am. Somebody other asked.
Achha, okay, never mind. So, okay. Virat, I believe you are also a research scholar?
Ma'am, I was previously faculty, okay. actually. Yes.
All right. Sorry. You had asked me for a government project, correct?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. I'm sorry. You were not the one who asked about the computer science. You asked me about the government project. Now, what kind of a passion do you have? Let me put it like that. Now, this is going to be for all of you. Passion.
Ma'am, that you had already answered. I am from electrical and electronics. So I will see the mighty electronics. गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया वेबसाइट रिगार्डिंग द इंस्ट्रक्शंस
या बट तुम्हारा पैशन किस चीज में तुम करना क्या चाहते हो जिंदगी में
मैम आई हैड पैशन इन द इलेक्ट्रिकल एंड इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स
फील्ड यार इलेक्ट्रिकल तो बहुत बड़ी लाइन है इट इज लाइक अ गंगा जमुना इलेक्ट्रिकल सो प्लीज स्पेयर मी डोंट जस्ट से इलेक्ट्रिकल टेल मी व्हाट इज इलेक्ट्रिकल के अंदर तुमको किस चीज के अंदर तुमको
मजा आता है? माइक्रो कंट्रोलर फील्ड.
एक्सेलेंट. तो क्या तुमने कभी सोचा कि जो आजकल ये जो हैव यू हर्ड अबाउट दिस थिंग व्हिच द चाइनीज हैव कम आउट विद, दिस इज नोन एज जी से देयर इज अ काइंड ऑफ आई एम फॉरगेटिंग द नेम. They've come out with a kind of, which you put, you know, the jacket what I'm wearing, you can just put that layer of that on my jacket. It's extremely soft, extremely light, and my jacket, cotton jacket ke andar aap isko laga doge to ye garam ho jayega. Mere students ne iske andar research kiya, to jo hum log khane ki, jab hum log dining table mein baithte hain, aur us dining table ke upar hum log ek, we put the mats, we put the placemats, we put the center tape. Thing, उसके अंदर उन्होंने they put the thing, this they had, when I had gone to Hong Kong in 2018, I had started working on a project with them there, and I brought it back with me to Dayalbagh, and I gave it to one of my MVOC students. I taught her, and then she went on with it. तो उसके अंदर उसने वो डाला, and these are again absolutely free of cost. Which are available on the net. And तो अगर आप जब उसमें plates अपना bowls रखते हो खाने का, तो वो battery operated होता है, वो खाना आपका गर्म हो जाता है. So these are the kind of things you can think about and work on. You know, आपने specially कहा chip design. तो chip design के लिए इसलिए मैंने आपको ये कहा है. क्योंकि अगर आप ये प्रोजेक्ट लेने जाओगे तो सबसे पहले आपको उनको बताना पड़ता है आपको क्या चाहिए, आप क्या चाहते हो, और उसके बाद आप जब प्रोजेक्ट आप लिख लेते हो तो आपको उसे प्रेजेंट करना पड़ता है. अगर आप कहोगे कि जी आप ऐसे वेगली बात करोगे, मुझे तो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स में शौक है, मैं तो इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियर हूँ, जैसे तेल लेने जाओ, आज के रोज हजारों इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियर्स पीएचडी होल्डर्स सड़कों पे घूम रहे हैं. यू हैव टू बी द बेस्ट एंड आई एम श्योर यू आर द बेस्ट. आई एम श्योर ऑल ऑफ यू आर द बेस्ट. सो
थैंक यू वेरी मच मैम.
थैंक यू.
थैंक यू सो मच मैम. वी विल शेयर योर ईमेल एंड कॉन्टेक्ट डिटेल टू द पार्टिसिपेंट सो दैट दे कैन डायरेक्टली कॉन्टेक्ट यू एंड आस्क देयर क्वेरीज टू यू. Now I would like to request our director sir to say thank you ma'am and welcome our second resource person Professor Shad Ahmad Khan sir from University of Oman. Sir, over to you.
Thank you all of you. That was great talking to all of you and listening to all of you. And I would really want all of you to be positive, come take projects, write research papers, and become an international institute. Thank you. And bye-bye.
Yes, sir. Director sir, over to you. Director sir, you are not audible.
Kya bolne padta hai? Kitne paise milenge?
All right, there might be some connectivity issue from the side of director sir. Mansi Mohanan.
Yes, ma'am.
Kindly thank ma'am.
Okay, as a saying goes, it isn't what you have to your pocket that makes you thankful, but what you have in your heart. And no way will I go from here without telling you that, ma'am, we are so grateful to you for taking out time and joining us and making us blessed with your presence. Ma'am, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to you for delivering such an informative session. The concept that you have explained to all of us about elements of innovation in classroom delivery, student engagement, and discussion approaches toward performance-based pay for management teachers. Ma'am, you very beautifully portrayed about research centers, job enables, and pay scales will surely create a mark in our lives. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such an interactive and enlightening session. Now, I would request Dr. Shivangi ma'am to kindly introduce our eminent resource person, Professor Dr. Shad Ahmad Khan, sir. Ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Mansi. Thank you once again, Professor Bhatnagar, ma'am. All right, now I would like to request Palak Gupta to introduce our resource for second resource person, Professor Shad Ahmad Khan, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, one and all present here. I, Palak Gupta, consider my pleasure and great privilege to welcome our honorable speaker for today's session, Professor Dr. Shad Ahmad Khan, sir. Dr. Shad Ahmad Khan, sir, is a dedicated and passionate business management learner who is open to adopt different working cultures and environment with educational specialization in the field of marketing and professional strength. In the field of business law, general management, and soft skills development, Dr. Shad Ahmad, sir, has organized more than 10 international conferences and many international webinars with a professional experience of more than a decade of working in three countries. Dr. Shad, sir, is widely traveled and well exposed to the global scenario. Presently, he is member of many international professional groups, editorial board of journals, and member of advisory board of 16 universities. Other key positions held by him during his professional term in the past are Program Coordinator, Global Immersion Program, GCBS, Royal University of Bhutan, Coordinator, Organizing Committee for International Conference, Workshop, and Program, Member, College Moderation Committee for Moderation of Examination, Question Paper, Evaluation and Final Results. Coordinator, GCBS Housing Policy Draft Task Force, GCBS, Royal University of Bhutan. Sir has published 30 papers publication in referred journals with index in Scopus and ABDC. Has published 7 books, has presented papers in more than 30 international conference, chaired, co-chaired 20 international conference. Sir is also recipient of Academic Achievement Award by Royal University of Bhutan for his innovative teaching pedagogy in 2014, Teaching Excellence Award by Indira Gandhi Research for Academic Excellence 2020 by Dr. Gaur Hari Singhania Institute of Management and Research, Kanpur, and Noble Academy, Pokhara, Nepal during 6th International HR Summit, Human Resources 2020, held at GHS IMR, Kanpur, India on 26 September 2020. Currently, sir is serving in College of Business University of Buraimi in Sultanate of Oman, and is Chair of Staff Professional Development Affiliation and Linkages Committee. Sir is also member of many key committees, including Academic Board, Curriculum Development, Food Manufacturing Unit, and University Innovation Center, etc. Sir, I am honored to welcome you in our Faculty Development Program, and I would request you to proceed with the program. Before that, I would like to call our director, sir, to say some word for our honorable guest.
And thank you, Ms. Palak, for, I think it's an honor on behalf of our chairperson as well as on president and all the stakeholders of the institute to welcome Professor Khan, who has such an illustrious career that having served in different countries and now currently serving the University of Buraimi Sultanate of Oman, and being such a highly resource person, highly efficient resource person, authored so many books, a very decorated professor. So I'm sure this session is going to be quite an exciting and enriching one. And I also look forward for this session. So I congratulate the organizers and also offer a deep sense of gratitude to Professor Khan for having agreed. I'm sure he must be having quite a hectic schedule, but despite that, considering the nature of the workshop and having delegates not only from a particular state but all different corners of the country and also from the different countries. I'm sure this session will be quite an enriching one for all the delegates. Thank you very much for this honor.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for finding a time for us. Now, stage is all yours. Kindly proceed further with your presentation.
Okay, thank you so much for inviting me here. I hope you all can hear me. Am I audible to all of you? It's become a norm, actually, to ask whether I'm audible or not. So thank you so much for inviting me with the permission of Dr. V.K. Chauhan, the organizing committee, Dr. Parul Bhatnagar, the FDP team. I am presenting myself before you. So without any further delay, I'll take you to my slides first and then we will have some discussion in the process. So let us get started with my slides and then we will be having some sort of discussion and I hope that there will be some takeaways from my session because I was going through the list of the resource persons that have been invited by your institute and the list is quite long. So I believe that many of the points that I'm going to present today is not new for you, but I still hope that if there can be some takeaways, it is really going to be something which is achieved, which I could consider as my achievement. So thank you so much for giving this opportunity. So the topic which I wanted to present today is blended learning. And I really want to relate myself with what Dr. Parul Bhatnagar was saying, that today computers have become an essential thing for everyone to learn. And it is almost indispensable to live a life without computers. So blended learning is actually a method of trying to create a balance between how to be online and offline at the same time. So why I'm delivering this session, I'm not a professional expert in computers, but the COVID-19 brought a lot of opportunities. And I also got an opportunity to attend this particular program, which certificate is in front of you. So whatever I'm going to share today, it's actually the outcomes and my learnings from this particular session. And there have been some other programs also, which I attended recently, those certificates I did not put here. But I will be creating a kind of things which we are going to do. My main focus will be what should we do and what should we not do, because our teaching community in a way is having a lot of issues when it comes to teaching online. Somewhere the answer is very simple. When this COVID-19 restrictions started getting imposed, majority of us, not just in India, but across the globe, many of the universities were not prepared to transit online. They all online teaching, if you look into the most of the accreditation document, online teaching, e-learning, usage, utilization was part of the planning. Somewhere, some of the universities were doing it partially to a greater extent, but it was not fully transformed on the online teaching. I must inform the floor here that for Sultanate of Oman, University of Buraimi was the first university to transit online. So we were the first university, even the largest university of the country, they shifted to online teaching after 1 month of the date when we started. So it was something which was very commendable on our part. And you can say that we were pioneers in shifting online. The day restrictions were imposed, the very next day we had shifted ourselves to online platforms. And thankfully to our management and our vice chancellor, we already had a plan to transit to this one. But we were not thinking to completely transit to online teaching. We were thinking to have a blended kind of learning, which I'm going to present today. And that was the reason majority of the chairs here, they received this training. So let's get started. So I will relate myself what Parul Bhatnagar was talking just now. And somewhere I feel that you'll be able to find a link. So let's talk about a learning journey, because Parul Bhatnagar was saying that we need to transit to online teaching and there is no other alternative. We need to be best. But how to become best, how to do something which is completely out of our comfort zone, because we all, the teaching community, the one of the reasons why people join teaching community is, though I'm grammatically wrong, people consider that it is the most noblest job. I'm grammatically wrong, but it is considered to be the most noblest job. People, they want respect. People, they want peace in their life. People, they want to learn more. They never want to kill the learner who is inside them. And that is the reason they joined the teaching profession. This has been a common connotation. There have been some of the other people also who are very interested in contributing something to the academic world, and that is the second degree of academic world. But let's get started, because this is your story. Let's get started. Just imagine yourself. I believe we need to go back 1 year back, somewhere in March 2020. And you will see that there are two parts of this whole circle, and this is your learning circle. So this is your learning circle. So we were somewhere here at the beginning. So we were here. We were asked to enter into a community which was not known to us. We were asked to enter into community, and this community was the community of online teachers. So we were asked to enter into a community, and it was unknown to us. Many of us, especially the elderly people, they had a heavy amount of resistance. Forget about the elderly people. Even the younger lots, they had heavy amount of resistance. Now what happened? It was resistance because we perceived that there are problems. And there were problems. We should not ignore the fact that there were not problems. There were problems. There were problems and there were issues. We were facing issues. But we had people like Professor Bhatnagar who were coming from within the circle as a helpers for all of us. I hope that even in your institute also, you must be having some of the helpers which became a kind of helper overnight, and everybody was resorting to them. So that has happened everywhere. I personally thank our IT head. Despite having so many students and so many faculty members in the university, he handled everyone single-handedly, and he was available round the clock for us. So there were helpers. And the moment we learned something, we became helpers for others. So that's how it started. So the thing is that if you are really learning computers, if you are not very much into it, one of the things is that we always have to look for helpers. When I say helpers, we have to look for the mentors who are revolving around us. And that can only come when we have the right evaluation of people who are around us. One of the problems with the teaching community today is that majority of the teaching community, especially in the developing world and the developed, the underdeveloped world, is that somewhere this ego is coming into their mind, and they are not willing to ask anyone. They say, we are teachers, we know everything, why should we ask? And that is the place where they lose out this opportunity. They lose out the helpers. I remember at some point of time, I got help from my students who taught me that they call us doctor here. They say, doctor, here, if you do like this, it will be better. So help can come from any side. So we have to look for these helpers. And then the revelation started happening. We realized that aha factor. Oh, okay, it is that simple. Just click here and join. Just click here and share the screen. See, I just click here and you can start writing. And then people who were innovative, they started looking for opportunities from these revelations. They said, why not we do something? It's a wonderful opportunity. Now, I'm sure if you were doing this particular FDP on a face-to-face basis, you would have spent at least hundreds of thousands on me in terms of INR, because you have to bear my travel ticket, you have to bear for my the stay, food, etc. But you see, now I'm sitting in my place. This is my house in Oman. I'm sitting in my house. You are sitting in your respective places, and we are attending this particular session, and we saw it as an opportunity. I was able to deliver, I believe I would have delivered at least 40 or 50 webinars during this COVID time, last 1.5 years. So it came as an opportunity. And we don't have to see our schedule much because as the director sir was saying that we have the hectic schedule, because earlier our schedule meant to be, if we have to travel to India, our schedule has to be at least 1 week time. Now it's hardly 1 hour that we have to spare ourselves, and we are available here. So that's how the opportunities, they came into picture. That's how the exchange of ideas started happening. We all started becoming innovative in our own teaching. Many of us, we started conducting viva voce presentations, etc., within our teaching frameworks. And we found that many of the times it is rewarding. There were a lot of rewards. Sometimes the reward came in the form of revenue. Sometimes the rewards came in the form of savings. Sometimes the reward came in the form of the free kind of knowledge that were available earlier, which was not accessible. There are many people who are sitting in different part of India and different part of the globe right now and who are attending this session. So people, they started seeing the rewards, and slowly the change started coming in, and from the unknown set, they came to the known set. So now we all are exposed to the online teaching. When I'm presuming that all of us are now exposed to the online teaching. So this has been the journey. Somewhere some things would have been less, something would have been low, but at an overall basis, somewhere this was a learning journey. Now I want all of you to recall about the innovations that you have taken at your own level in this process. Try to recall those innovations, and then we will be able to move further, because it was online that was with us, but somewhere we were thinking that we are going to continue with this even if the normalcy is prevailed. So once we achieve the normalcy, still we will continue some of these practices. For example, for me, I always used to conduct my class quiz through these printout papers, distributing papers to the student, invigilating in the class, and they would take the answers on that paper, and then later on I'll sit, sometime my wife will help me. So we will sit together and we'll start evaluating. We had platforms like Black Moodle in place with us, but we never used it because we didn't want it to use that one. Why to learn something new when we are comfortable with what we already know? Then we started conducting quiz online, and we were surprised that, wow, it gives you the results automatically. The students can see the feedback automatically. You don't have to spare your time. You don't have to call them for a special session that come at 3 o'clock, we have a quiz for 1 hour. You just put it on the online system. The platform is there. By the way, just now my students are appearing for quiz. So I gave them a time slot from morning 8 o'clock till evening 8 o'clock. At any time they can come, they can log in, they can appear for the quiz, and it is for 1 hour. So I gave them convenience. I bought convenience for myself. And at the end of the day, I will go, I will check. It will be automatically evaluated. They will have their marks. I will have my marks for my record. And it's a win-win situation. So even if we transit from online to face-to-face method, this is something we learned, and we are going to continue with it. So similarly, you must be having a lot of things that you might have. We have learned how to embed our questions within the YouTube videos. So that is something which we have learned. So we put the videos on our platforms. The students cannot skip any part. They cannot fast forward it. They have to watch the full video, and there are questions coming up. So through that, we are able to have some class participations in between. We have used some of the platforms like mentimeters.com, where you can take online poll. I believe in Zoom also, there is something called as online poll. We can take polls right now. Then you can separate the sessions at different, you can create separate rooms for discussions. So these are so many things that we have revealed. Even the platforms also, they have tried to maximize their utility in terms of providing us more number of options. Zoom was not having these many options earlier. So now they have started giving these options also. So many things have happened. So now let's move ahead. Clear my screen, please. Okay. So now the thing is, what is this blended learning which you are talking about? Because we all are believing that we will be switching to the face-to-face learning and teaching once this COVID-19 is over. By the way, the third wave and fourth wave and the fifth wave is also expected. We all are in the second wave right now. So let us see and wish that soon the world is back to the normal days. But what is blended learning? Because this is something which has really come on surface, and tomorrow, the future belongs to blended learning. If we don't adopt to blended learning now, we will be outliers and we will not have jobs with ourselves. Those of us who are already in a well-settled job, it's a different story for us, but those of you who are newcomers, who are trying to aspire for newer jobs, for the newer institutions, they will have to have the blended learning learn for themselves, and they have to adopt themselves with this one. So what is blended learning? It's actually a hybrid learning that combines offline and online teaching. Now, when I say online teaching, there are a lot of myth that is associated. And we need to overcome those myths. So today, what I'm going to do is that I will be basically doing a myth buster for most of you, which was a myth for me also earlier. And it was busted during the attending of these sessions. So what we do is that it is an integration of a face-to-face classroom teaching. And then we also integrate the online learning experiences to it. We were already doing it. Please mind it. We were already doing it. Many institutions, just in the last 10 years, if you recall, many institutions, they started coming up with the concept of smart classroom. If you recall, smart classroom was what? What was a smart classroom? It was integrating the smart features of the lecturing or teaching into the classroom. For example, showing videos, audio visuals. It initially started with audio visuals. That time, projector was a luxury. Now projectors have become a kind of necessity for most of the classrooms now. So it's no longer a smart classroom. Audio visual was something which was luxury, that I'm not only teaching on the whiteboard or blackboard, but I'm also telling you that, see, this is how it is done. So I'm showing you the video. Then came the smarter classroom, where even the Wi-Fi enabled classrooms came, where these system was also integrated with internet. And now we were live, we were online, we were able to have a digital interface associated with our classrooms. So we were doing it actually. It was not something new. Now the only new thing which has come up is that the distance has come. Now we are sitting at two different places. Earlier that required us to sit at the same place and learn. Now through blended learning, learning can happen sitting at two different places. Now there have been so many reasons for this one. You see the penetration of internet devices, the tablets, mobile phones, laptops, that has increased now. Relatively, the internet services and infrastructures has improved. India is perhaps one of the nation which offers cheapest internet in the world. I was shocked when I saw the Wi-Fi packages for India. It is almost 1/8 of what we are paying here in Oman. So you are living in luxury. So there were so many things. India can become they can be a boom for India through these online platforms. So what we do is we have the traditional classroom, we merge the online platforms into it, and this blend in between, we call it blended learning. Very simple words. Now there are so many opportunities. Let me cover these opportunities briefly, and then I will come on those myths and mythbusters and bust those myths. So first opportunity for students is the flexibility. If I have to conduct the same quiz for my students at 3 o'clock, I wanted all the students to come in the classroom at 3 o'clock and leave by 4 o'clock. So it was not flexible. Now I have given them the opportunity because the holy month of Ramadan is on in Oman. So I have to understand that also. So somewhere earlier that was a restriction for us. We could not do much, but now the flexibility in India, Navratri is going on, for example. So now there's flexibility. I have given them the time slot, morning 8 o'clock to evening 8 o'clock. Anytime they have to spare 1 hour, they can come, they can appear for the quiz, I'll get my marks. Because ultimately my objective is to check whether they have learned something or not. So my objective is getting fulfilled, their objective is getting fulfilled. That is accessibility. Earlier they had to travel to the university campus. Our university campus is around 15 kilometers away from the city center. So they have to move to the university campus, appear there and then come back. Now they can move, they just have to look for an internet device nearby, and many a time they have the internet device in their hand, so it's accessible now for them. It has increased peer support. This is something which has really come up with online learning. Many of the time the peer support has increased because in the class, because of the classroom discipline, we were actually hampering the peer support that students get from each other, unless and until you organize special discussion sessions. But through online teaching now, many a times we have observed that students, they resolve their issues at their own level. It never reaches to the lecturers or professors. So it has increased the peer support amongst them. They have a higher level of autonomy. They have a deeper learning now because they are more exposed to the different kind of scenarios. But yes, I still feel that the face-to-face teaching has no substitute. That is the reason we are promoting blended learning. Teachers, they have the monitoring progress. You can check who has done it, who has not done it, especially for the larger student sections. It becomes really easy if you have the online platforms, because the logarithms of these platform, they automatically tells you. For example, we are using Moodle. We just have one option. Show me the list of students who have not submitted their quiz or not submitted their assignment or not have attended the class. It generates the attendance report also. So we have the monitoring progress. We can differentiate. We can see different kind of tools and techniques. So it gives us various kinds of graphs and other things. So we have the differentiations. In a way, we are becoming more efficient now, because earlier conducting one quiz or one assignment was difficult. Now we can conduct more number of it. So efficiency has really improved. Plus, we have saved our time, actually. We can just put one quiz or one task in the platform. Now, for example, delivering lectures also has become easy. You can deliver a lecture, record it, and put it on the platform. And as and when the students want, they can come and they can clarify themselves. For example, when my students, they ask me for any doubt clearing session, the first thing I do is I send them my class recording. I say that you can refer this recording of mine. And still, if you have any problem, you can refer back to me. So somewhere we have become efficient, because we are able to utilize the resources in a much better way. And tracking and reporting has also become very easy, because these are very much legitimate. So there is no fear of losing paper. Obviously, online platform, they come up with the online threats and cyber crimes. We cannot neglect that, but the chances are less. If you have a good system, the probability of having it is very low, but chances of losing a paper is much higher as compared to becoming victim of the cyber crimes. The challenges is motivation among students. Because somewhere we all, since we were not motivated to shift online into the online teaching, we could not motivate our students also. We simply imposed the online teaching and this blended form of learning on them. So somewhere the challenge is students' motivation. Unfortunately, the teaching faculty was still trained in using this online platforms, but we could not train our students to do it. We could not get time. So many times the unfamiliarity of the student. But at the top of it, student self-management has been a major challenge. Somewhere the students were not able to manage themselves. Because in the traditional face-to-face learning method, what happens is that your frame of mind is fixed, that you have to attend this class from 8 to 9, second class from 9 to 10, third class from 10 to 11. So your mind is fixed that you have to do this. But suddenly when you give them the flexibility, the issues like procrastination, laziness, drowsiness, or busy in somewhere else, not able to prioritize the work, this kind of issue comes into picture. And the student, they lack in terms of managing themselves. So at times you have to be after them, reminding them, and then you have to be really after them, pushing them that to please submit on time. But this has been one of the issues which comes in. Then digital inequality is still, not only in India, in other part of the world also, is still the network penetration of internet is not that good in many of the remote areas. For example, Oman, by the living standards and everything, it is a much developed country. But still we have the locations where the internet penetration is not that good, the networks are not coming that good. And that is something which we consider. Plus the living style of the people, we have to see the different social class of the society available with us, because students who are coming to us, though they have paid our fees, it does not mean that they all are from the affluent class. So many of the students, they have the digital inequality in terms of the devices that they have. So we cannot push all of them to have extraordinary kind of smartphones or extraordinary kind of tablets. But that's the reason you have to really be mindful in becoming too technological advanced teacher before switching into the blended learning, because many students are there. We in the University of Buraimi, we identified 200 students when we started online learning. We identified 200 students who cannot afford the devices. And we had to provide them the devices. The university has to help them. Now, the problem was that you can give them the devices. What about the recurring cost? Because they have to pay for internet. And internet is not that cheap here in Oman. So we even had to buy them the internet data plans on a monthly basis. So that was something that we tried to have over that we tried to do here. But still, we cannot say that we were completely successful. Then the confidence of using it, because still, once they have submitted, they are not sure whether it is submitted really or not. Once they have marked their presence in the class, they are not really sure whether they have been marked presence or not. So that is the confidence level. And that was quite obvious. It will go eventually when things becomes normal for everyone. For teachers, we have been loaded from front. This online teaching, it came as an additional load for the teachers. It did not come as a substitute or as an alternative. It came as a load, altogether different load. I remember even our management, they asked us to teach every class online, because somewhere we have to understand that if you're not engaging in our class on a regular basis, the students may complain that the teacher has not taught us. But many a time we were doing what we were doing in the face-to-face classes, the same thing we adopted in the online classes. And that's the way we were frontally loaded. Plus, we have to create all the material online and it takes time. Now, once you have moved to that system, in the second year or third year, you will see that you can reutilize the past material that you have uploaded. But in the initial days, it is really a load for the teachers. It demands time. It really demands time. Plus, it requires support and documentation, because now it's really not, the management of the universities are not really sure whether you are engaging in the class or not. Work from home, at least when you are there in the university campus, there is some level of supervision available, but that's where the documentation comes into picture. Now you have to prove that you have actually engaged yourself in the online platform. So that is again coming as a major challenge. Plus, most of the universities still today, they don't have the framework. They just purchased this system from online world, and they could not develop their IT infrastructure to that level, and they did not have the framework that where to go when something wrong happens. So that was something. And of course, the training of teachers, because unless the teachers are trained, we cannot train our students. And something which was common between both of them was confidence. Even teachers are not sure. Even we were not sure still. Means we still have some of the teachers who conduct the examinations online, and once the exam papers are submitted, they take the printout of all the papers and then they evaluate it manually. And then they again scan it and they upload it. So somewhere that is the issue of confidence, because we are not really confident on using these platforms. So how to do it? Means from the teacher's point of view, how to recover this one? So let us discuss about some of the teaching strategies that we have to do. And this is where I will be busting some of the myths that. So first thing, majority of the teachers, they have been engaged in online teaching by way of delivering content. Content delivery, it can happen through videos, it can happen through recorded sessions. It does not have to happen through live sessions. So the purpose of having a live session is to engage the students. So the focus has to be on engaging the students. But unfortunately, because of the mindset of the students, the management, and ourselves, the teaching fraternity, we are more focused on delivering the content. So unless and until we see a teacher in front of us delivering a lecture to us, we are not satisfied, we are not contented. So that is the mindset of the students. And since the teacher has not engaged the class and he has not delivered a particular chapter or particular slide, it is assumed that he has not taught in the class. This is where the entire difference comes into picture, because somewhere the university teaching has to be differentiated with the school teaching. School teaching is more focused on content, but university teaching is more focused on exploration. And exploration will come when the teaching, when the teacher is able to promote the discussion and engagement in the class, when the students can explore themselves, when the analytical skills is developed among the students. Although there are some limitations, we cannot ignore it, but for teaching, the focus has to be on engaging the students, not delivering the content. Plus, online and face-to-face must seamlessly interact. So there has to be a seamlessness when we are involved in online and face-to-face teachings. because that is where the technology comes into picture, the digital interface comes into picture. So for those of you who are having weak internet right now, my voice must not be reaching to you. It must be breaking right now. So that's where you will be facing some issues. Set clear expectations and responsibility. This is the next thing that we have to understand. For this purpose, I always suggest the teaching committee today that try to identify the objective of your lecture. Unless and until you have the objective of your lectures set, objective of your teaching set, you will not be able to fulfill those expectations. So normally, for example, there are chapters which is just informative, which is just like anybody can read and understand those chapters. You really do not have to engage yourself. So the outcomes are just delivering or something which is memorizing kind of thing. For example, who was the father of economics? You just have to remember. So when you are trying to remember something, it does not require a teacher specifically coming and telling you. It can be done through any sort of information given. So there has to be clear expectations and responsibilities. So what you expect from the teachers and what you expect from the students, it has to be clear. Then alignment of learning outcomes. This is something which is very important. The alignment of learning outcomes with learning activities and assessment. So for example, if the learning outcome is to promote teamwork and leadership among students, if that is the learning outcome, our assessment and the learning activities should be aligned with that. Now, for example, my learning outcome is to promote teamwork and leadership among students. Okay, I thought somebody is asking question. Anyway, so if, for example, my objective is to promote or inculcate teamwork and leadership among students, and I am giving them a quiz, it does not really make sense. Teamwork and leadership can be assessed through a group assignment or a group project or a group discussion, but giving them a quiz to assess their teamwork or leadership does not really align with that. Similarly, asking them to write essay on leadership does not really align. So we have to see what is the ultimate learning outcome that we are targeting on, and then we have to align our activities and assessments based on that. So you see your curriculum, you see your course, and then try to identify what is the learning outcome. Most of the courses have the course objectives. And now in the international accreditation, there's something known as the learning outcome. It has become an essential information to be incorporated in your course specification. Course specification in India is known as subject or module specification. So it depends what you call it, but it is going to be same. So these are the key considerations for teaching. The first thing is the instruction method. How can a specific learning objective be delivered most effectively? Do you really require a live session, live lecture session? If the answer is yes, go for it. If the answer is no, it can be taught through a video, it can be taught through an exercise, if it can be taught through a quiz, assignment, project, then there are alternatives. It's not always the teacher should go for an online session and give lecture. If the lecture is really needed, then deliver the lecture. So just try to identify that how effectively, what is the best way of delivering this one. Interaction and assessment. Provide opportunity to practice skills and build knowledge. This can only come when interaction and assessment is there. So for example, we are doing online examination, but after online examination, at least let us have some discussion session with students, because unless and until we have the discussion session with students, students will not come to know what was their mistake. There are some high level questions which we often ask. Now, this era of evaluation is based on Bloom's taxonomy, where we have to ask the questions based on evaluation, analyzing, creativity. So these are some of the high level questions that we are, application based questions. So this is where we need to provide students a platform to interact, where their analysis has gone wrong, where their application has gone wrong. So this will only come when the interaction is there and they are able to interact with you. Of course, for this, the class size also is going to matter. Those places where the class size is really big, it becomes really difficult for the teachers to manage. Then the technology, what technology is available to you? Many a time we try to blame our management for not giving us the best technology, but somewhere we have to see that what technology is available to us and our students, And because we all are living in our limitations and we have to function within the limitations, we cannot really aspire to do something great because of a particular technology available. So we have to really estimate, or we have to analyze what technology is available, and we have to work within our within the framework of the technology available to us. Now, for example, Zoom is not available for us when we are teaching our classroom because we are doing everything on MS Teams. And MS Teams has its own advantages. We cannot compare it with Zoom. So we have MS Teams, you have Zoom. So we have our own areas, we have our own technologies. Both the technologies are good. They have their own limitations. We have to function within the limitation. Then third thing is organization of the content, that how we can sequence the organize, how we can organize or sequence the content that we are intended to deliver and how it can be nicely done. Then communication. Somewhere we need to inculcate the habit among students. The way they are checking their WhatsApp chat every time, somewhere we have to inculcate that they should check the platform updates also, the platform notifications also. So what we have done in Oman is we have tried to mark ourselves on the WhatsApp group, because we consider that the WhatsApp group is the fastest mode of communication now. And we had a very serious, very strict rules and regulation pertaining to the communication process that we had, what students can discuss with us and what students cannot. We had the policy for that one, and it is working absolutely fine for us. We have MS Teams, we have GoToMeeting, we have Moodle, but we are, for communication process, we are relying more on WhatsApp chats and emails. So, because that was something our students were already habitual to. Now, the next issue is synchronous and asynchronous teaching. This is where the entire myth comes into the picture. Synchronous learning is this one, which we are doing right now in the real time. I'm speaking and you are listening. This is synchronous learning. It can happen face-to-face also, but when I'm talking about synchronous learning, it is basically online. So this is happening real time. Asynchronous is, it can be done through online channels without real-time interaction. Now, online teaching is all about creating a balance between synchronous and asynchronous teaching. So how it can be done, please try to understand this one. Now, what happens is the teacher is giving a theoretical representation to the student. It gives a theoretical representation to the student, and student has a conceptual representation. The student understands the concept. So you are giving him a theory, clarifying a concept to him. He's understanding that concept. Okay, this is one method. It is known as discursive level. The second method is that student, it gives an experimental environment. And student is giving a kind of a behavior. He is giving you a kind of his reflection. He's giving you his feedback. Now what happens is, if you're just transferring him the theoretical knowledge, he will show you back. Okay, what is the first principle of law? Or what is the first principle of motion? He will tell you something. First rule of accounting, he will tell you something. So he's just responding back. He's re-articulating. But when the teacher is getting into the experimental environment, just imagine you are a leader, or you are made the prime minister of this country for next 1 month, or you are the prime minister of the country during this pandemic time, what will you do? Now you have set a goal for the student, and now a student will start giving you feedback, which will be action oriented. This is where the interactive level comes into picture. And this is where the differentiation of the synchronous and asynchronous comes into picture. So let me simplify this entire conversational framework for you. So when you are simply going for a synchronous class, the synchronous class should be more towards getting the feedback, getting the interaction, discussions. That is the purpose of having a feedback or asynchronous sessions. If you just want to take the re-articulation back, you gave some information and you want to take the re-articulation back, that who is Sultan of Oman, who is Prime Minister of India, you just want a specific answer, which does not require much of the analytical powers, it can be done through asynchronous method also. The quiz which I'm conducting today is actually a process of asynchronous teaching. They have been given some information. and they are going to re-articulate it back. I don't have to mark my physical presence there. So I'm going to get it back. But in this kind of session, because I'm sitting with the esteemed group of people, we can expect some sort of interaction. So what is ABC of learning design? So there are three things that we have to see: arena, blended, and connected, which is known as ABC. Sorry. So the first thing that we have to understand is, what should we deliver? What should be taught to the students? And that will only come when we understand what is unique about my course or my module. If I have understood what is unique about my course or my module, we will be able to understand what exactly I'm going to deliver. Then blended, what is the mix of activities that you can use? What kind of thing you can show? Videos, you can show them, you can give them the projects, you can conduct the quiz, you can have the interactive sessions, you can call them for a discussion with you. So what kind of things you want to really have? Sometimes it really becomes very important to sit with the students and discuss with them. And that's where the face-to-face learning comes into picture, especially for guiding the research projects, especially. Sometimes it's not really possible to teach them online. Somewhere you have really have to show them how you are doing things, and you have to call them face-to-face because their learning capacity is really going down. Then connected, how are assessment, institutional policies, and wider program things are incorporated, how all these things are linked with each other. So that is where the ABC of learning design comes into picture. And this has to be something which really requires your time at the beginning of teaching. So if your institute offers you some time to prepare yourself, you really have to think on these areas if you really want to switch on blended learning. So this is the concept map of blended learning. So blended learning model is very simple. We have blended learning, we have learning environment components, which has the traditional classrooms. Then we have the distance learning. And this distance learning is divided into two parts. The first part is synchronous learning. Second part is asynchronous learning. So synchronous, which requires our online presence in real time. Asynchronous, which does not require our online presence in the real time. It can be done in your absence also. Means both the parties, teacher and student, do not have to be at the same time, at the same place. Then we need to have the instructional component, what things we are going to instruct, and then the media component. So if this is the learning model concept map that we have to consider for blended learning. So this is actually, if I really have to conclude everything, this is actually a tri-dimensional blended learning module. So these are the three things: learning environment, instruction component, and media component, which is all interrelated to each other. So what it does is, learning environment component evaluates the learning environment, whether it is synchronous or asynchronous, and it supports the instructional objectives, whether I have achieved my objective or not. Whereas the instructional component, it is used to select the most appropriate strategy to achieve that learning outcome. So for example, if I just want to have some poll in real time, I can use it on Zoom. I can use Mentimeters, and I can show it to my class that, see, within your class, for example, when I have to teach them diversity among their own classrooms, I give them a question, and then based on their responses, like which kind of soap they use, for example, which brand of soap they use, what kind, if they were supposed to, they were offered three times of drink, which drink they will prefer the most, or which drink they'll pick up first. So it shows some sort of diversity. Then the media component, it is used to evaluate the most appropriate media. So these are the three learning modules which is available. So final note, it's not just about the technology, it's about the people. So learning and education is a process which is going on. Learning is the outcome, and technology is the means. So don't forget this particular, it's very, very traditional now, this communication diagram, sender and receiver. In between is the delivery system. So focus on the learning outcome. That's all I want to say. That ultimately target on the learning outcomes. Don't really get fizzy about teaching everything online. That is actually against the concept of blended learning. So we have to improve the human performance. And with this, I'll rest my case here. And thank you so much, everyone. If you have any questions, the house is open. I can see some of you are posting your questions there. Before I take up your questions, let me just show my gratitude to some of these people. Mrs. Alka Das Gupta Ji, who is the chairperson of BPD Group of Education. Shri Viraj Sagar Das Ji, Professor Bhavish Kumar Chauhan Ji, who is director of BBD ITM. Professor Manish Singh Ji, Dr. Shivangi Tiwari, who has been actually instrumental of bringing me here. And I hope that there were many people who were part of the organizing team, resource persons and lovely participants who include students and the existing professors and upcoming teachers. So that's all. Let me close my sharing now.
Thank you so much, sir, for wonderful deliberation. Participants, if you would like to ask anything, you can directly ask to sir or put your query in a chat box.
Good afternoon, sir. How to take care of the distractions in online teaching and learning process?
The first thing is most of these online platforms, it gives you the facility of recording your sessions. And then what you can do is you can share these things. Now, see, certain things we cannot really substitute. For example, for me especially, I'm really missing maintaining eye contact with my students. I can see here also most of your cameras are off. So I really don't know how many of you are awake, how many of you are somewhere, how many of you are attentive, how many of you are not. Because somewhere the eye contact, it really tells you whether the people have understood something or not. So we really have to see, this is something which I'm missing, because somewhere the teacher gets an informal feedback through the eye contact. And that nod, when the people are agreeing to you by nodding their head, it really plays an important role. So that is one of the distraction, because you are just talking to the screen. So it is, first of all, it is a distraction for you. Secondly, the distraction for the students, sometimes their microphones are on, sometimes some of the fuzzy activities are going on. This can be done if you really have a good platform, because there are some of the administrative setups that you can do before conducting the session. For example, the organizers have the power whether to give microphone rights to everyone or not. They have the powers. I hope that is the distraction which you're talking about. Internet and network-based distraction is something which is beyond our control. And it happens with me also. So what I do is I say that, okay, I'm recording this session and you will have the access to the classroom recording after this class. And if you have any issues, I have created a discussion forum for myself. So it is beyond the classroom hours. I say that you can fix an appointment with me and you can come to me at any time. So in that process, what happens is that they search for a good network zone. So for example, they are in their villages. They don't have good internet there. So they can, whenever they are coming towards the towns or cities, they can come and they can interact with me. So that's how I do. Plus face-to-face, we are always available for our students. So this, I hope this satisfies your answer.
That's very nice, Professor. What I really feel is that in this particular session, when we started the classes, so some of the children very enthusiastically quoted the same. They said that, ma'am, online is fine. But, you know, we don't get that feel. We don't get that, we don't get that energy of being in the class. You know, like agreed that since we are catering to most of the technology, courses and management courses, so the children are really technologically advanced, yet they still, the students feel, leave apart the teachers. I mean, the teachers, at least senior teachers like me, are more from the old school of teaching, right? Because I've already had more than 25 years of teaching career. So that way, I used to feel that maybe because of that, I like the classroom teaching more than the online teaching. But then when the students reiterated the same, what to do about that? They feel the same, that online mode, they don't tend to focus more because, you know, they feel that any time of the day they can watch and they can revisit. But that, they say that that loses their focus into what is being taught at that very time. The real time teaching is not that effective.
I think one part I missed out. It was not part of the presentation, I believe. The first thing is this blended learning. Who is going to decide the quantum of blend is actually the teacher himself. How much he is going to teach face-to-face, how much he is going to do online. And in online also, how much is going to be synchronous and how much is asynchronous is to be decided by the teacher. If he feels that only 5% is asynchronous and 95% has to be synchronous, it's well and fine, because somewhere the focus is on the planning phase. You really, the teacher knows the best. The teacher knows his capacity. The teacher knows the student's capacity. For example, we have some students, if we start teaching them everything through asynchronous method, they won't be able to understand anything. We have to understand that we have shy students, introvert students in the class who don't come forward unless and until you push them up. You have to call their names. That do you have any problem? Suddenly they'll say, yes, yes, I have an issue. So it's actually the teacher. He is the best assessor of his situation. So the blended is just to have the combination. It does not talk about that you should have 50-50% of both. It never talks about that. So for us, for example, for those of you, let me share what we are doing here. At the beginning of the semester, when the course is assigned to us, we get around 1 week time where we have to come up with our own course plan. So we decide that how many lectures we are going to take as online session, one-to-one, how many sessions will be asynchronous. And if we go back to the face-to-face learning, that time we will also see that how many things we can do through face-to-face method. So it is the teacher who has to submit this report. Then then we have the flexibility, up to 20% change we can do to our curriculum at any point of time. So I believe the management supports you, then this is something can be done. I have special respect for the elderly people, because for them it was really difficult to switch, and they have done fantabulously well by adopting these challenges. I remember one of my professor who were against the PPT concept. He never used to say, he said, what PPT? And he is a person who was delivering a lecture on PPT just recently. And he called me and he said, I'm delivering most of my lectures on PPT now. So the way people have transitioned, the way they have changed their mindset is really phenomenal, actually. I hope I have answered your question, Professor Manish.
Yeah, I'm Professor Manisha Shikha. That's perfectly yes. Fine, Doctor. This is, you know, it's really not a question. It's my dilemma that, you know, how to, once I know the children well, I know exactly in and out of the child, because who's understanding, who's not understanding, who's paying attention, who's not paying attention, who's able to be in tune with my communication, who's a slow learner, who's a fast learner, all that. And in these unforeseen times when we haven't seen the kids at all and they're only on the online mode, it's a kind of a hallucination whether the child is really connected, not connected. Whether the child is answering me or one of their siblings in the house is saying yes or no, all this is there.
Obviously, this is one of the challenges, actually. This cannot be ignored. This is one of the challenges.
Right.
It's not even child. You know, these days, some of the academic corruption has also come into picture. There are some, you can say, unemployed people or who are free these days. They have started taking money and they appear for the examinations on behalf of the students. So academic integrity is really at stake. So we cannot do something on this. But the thing is that we can only plan our assessment strategies in such a way that we can minimize it. We cannot completely eliminate it. We can just minimize it. So people very are well outsourcing.
Right. People thank you. Very well said. Even I have my deep concern about the students who are going to be graduating within these 2 years of pandemic. I really have a lot of sympathy on to exactly how learned are they going to be after they graduate from the university. And what kind of a future do they see for themselves in future? Thank you.
Yes. One of my professor here in University of Buraimi, he often interacts with the students and he says that, my dear students, you will get good marks. You will get 90 plus, you will get A. But ultimately, when you appear for your interview, who is going to hire you? How far you are employable? So now some of the students, they can get this realization because this is something which has to come from their within. We cannot do something on this. Ultimately, it is their life, their career, their choices. We as a teachers, we have our own limitations. So completely agree with you, Professor Manisha Shukla. Any other
very nice deliberation. I really enjoyed your session. Thank you.
Thank you so much. My pleasure.
Good afternoon. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Shad. This is Hassan from Bangladesh. Thank you so much. Very wonderful presentations. And the blended learning is a similar topic of mine. And I have one question. It is, what would be the learner outcomes of learning continuity that ensures technological interventions in blended learning environment? Thank you.
Actually, the learner's outcome for any sort of this kind of programs, it depends really entirely on your courses. Normally, any course we divide into six parts. So what happens is that the first part is something which a person should remember and memorize. So that is the first part. The second part is the application, that how far he's going to apply it in the real life scenario. The third part is analyzing, where he can improvise and innovation can come into picture. Then third part is the creativity, whether when he is able to blend it with something new. And the fourth part, we always see the transferable skill, whether he can transfer it to somebody else or not. So we can call it a community skill or something. So revolving around these few arenas, it really depends at what is going to be the outcome. But you can really design the outcome based depending on your own course contents and your syllabus or your outcomes. For blended learning, what I can suggest is whatever I have presented today have been a mixture of the information and has been a mixture of our experiences. Now it is up to you whether you are going to apply it or not. So those of you who are going to apply blended learning, it is going to be the outcome from this FDP session. So if the moment you adopt a blended learning, in the moment normalcy is restored, it is going to be the outcome. So somewhere the percentage of faculty members switching to blended learning after the normalcy is restored will be something which I'll consider as the outcome. And then how many of you are going to educate and re-educate your co-peers, your students, etc., will be something which I'll consider as outcome. I hope that answers.
Thank you, sir.
My pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Any other participant?
Yes, sir, you put it a very nice point regarding the student point of view. The self-management. If the student community wants to.
Dr. K. Chilapa, I cannot hear you properly. There is some. Either yes, you are too away from the microphone.
Yes, it is now. Sir, now it is audible, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, your presentation is very nice and motivates all the participants. So thanks for the organizing committee, first of all. My question is, you first of all, you told regarding the digital literacy among the students. First thing, the student community should have a self-management to learn something. So I am a faculty of commerce. I have 15 years of experience. So first 5 years, so I am a teach with my digital mode of state. Here in the pandemic situation, many steps are taken by the government of Tamil Nadu, particularly 2GB free data. And the SIM card also, you should give the student community with a free of cost. But the students are not seeing that why the government facilitated to us. My question, how to inculcate the opportunities and avenue for the digital learning mode among the student community? My humble request to you, sir, please.
Okay, thank you so much. As long as I could understand your question, I'll try to address it. Though the pandemic is on, but I must share some of the real life stories with you. For example, in University of Buraimi, I understand that you are a professor of commerce, and in commerce also there's courses like income tax, accounting, etc. So at times it becomes really difficult to deliver to the students through online platforms because we really don't know whether they are understanding or not. So I must share with you some of the practices that we tested in University of Buraimi. I'll not say we have adopted it. We tried to have the blended learning for those courses which required labs. For example, we have College of Health Sciences, and you can understand that health sciences cannot be delivered purely on online mode. So we have labs where students have to be called and they have to undergo the labs. So we adopted the blended learning there. Similarly, for some courses, we invited the students to visit the campus face-to-face so that whenever, so for that purpose, in order to have the social distancing norm were in place, we divided the students into groups. So group of five students were there, and then they were given some time slot so that not a crowd is rushing to the campus in one go. And then we have very strict COVID protocols. For us, the temperature, sanitization, everything is done at the gate itself. So we have very strict protocols for that. So that was one thing which we did for face-to-face learning. For blended learning, regarding motivating the students, this is something which is going to come only when the teachers and students are going to discuss with each other. Because ultimately, somewhere what happens is there's a kind of disconnect that teachers are having with the students. Teachers are facing some problem, but they don't tell to their students. So students, they don't understand what was the problem. For example, network issues are not an issue which the students have monopoly on. It can be something which can be faced by a teacher himself. For example, if my Wi-Fi is having some problem today, it can be an issue with me also. It's not that I'm completely immune to these kind of issues. But what happens is that we tend to say what student will feel, in Hindi you say bezati ho jayegi, and that kind of thing, that we will lose our trust. So that is something which we have to really understand. So we have to create a kind of interaction and discussion with the students, number one. Number two, this realization will only come when you are going to tell the students about the consequences. Because what happens is that our education system is such that marks have become everything. When marks becomes everything, students will try to identify ways and means to grab the best percentage of marks. And then you have the facilitators in the market. You don't have to forget that you have the facilitators in the market. A person who doesn't know anything about, who doesn't know A of accounting, will be scoring 95% because he knows somebody who is expert of accounting. So somewhere this realization has to be put inside the student's mind that, have you really learned something? I just remember one of the student case. It was in Royal University of Bhutan. He was a topper in accounting and he was selected for Royal Audit Authority. Now, Royal Audit Authority is the highest body for auditing in Bhutan. They asked him a simple question. What do you mean by capital? And he could not answer. Now, the consequence was that not only he lost his job, he also threatened the job for all the people who were selected from his institute. So there was a kind of trickle down effect. And then the employment opportunities for the upcoming batches was also affected. So this is something that we have to inform. These are the real life stories which the people like senior teachers like you, the directors, the senior professors in the universities, they already know. The thing is that don't keep the students misinformed. Inform them that placements can only be guaranteed to you only if they are going to do well. And ultimately, when they go to the market and they are able to establish a good brand image, ultimately they are paving the way for their juniors also. So somewhere tell them about the responsibility, and the students, once they understand this one, they are really responsible. They are open to adopt this change. Once you become senior, once you have more experience, your adaptation to change, it declines. But when you are at a fresh, your mind is fresh, you are still new, you are still adaptive to the greater amount of changes available around you. So that will be my take on this.
Thank you, sir. My pleasure.
Any other participant would like to add something or want to ask? All right, sir. Thank you so much. Now I would like to request our director, sir. Sir, kindly give a brief gratitude to our resource person.
Thank you, Dr. Shivangi Tiwari, convener of the program and organizing team, for giving me this honor once again. Of course, it was really, I think, enriching for me also on a personal behalf as well as on a professional behalf, the way Dr. Khan really elaborated different aspects, because we are still in the process. This blended learning, of course, is something which is going to stay for long, even post-COVID, as Professor Khan mentioned it very aptly. So we must really make a balance, as he said, that, you know, it is all, after all, you who have to decide that what is going to be the percentage. But something as a blend has to be done, that is, there is no choice. So I think he has really gave a very right perspective for all of us. And I'm sure this will make a major takeaway. We all of them will be taking a major takeaway, and that it will really keep us balanced in terms of perspective and time to come. So I really offer a deep sense of gratitude from all the stakeholders of this educational group, and on behalf of all these esteemed delegates who have been attentively, you know, listening to him in full strength and very curious, and I'm sure they have all been analysts. So thank you very much for this deliberation, and thank you to organizers. Over to the anchor.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to request Palak Gupta to give a formal vote of thanks. Palak, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. As it is said that best and beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt by heart. Thank you is one such a prayer among them. I consider it is my great privilege to propose a vote of thanks to all the dignitaries who have witnessed it as a memorable and successful fourth day of faculty development program. For the successful completion of today's session, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to our first eminent speaker of this session, Honorable Guest Professor Parul Bhatnagar Ma'am, who highlighted on element of innovation in classrooms, delivery, student engagement and discussion approaches toward performance-based pay for management teachers. She beautifully portrayed about job enablers, pay scales, innovation in education, resource center, women empowerment, and many more. I would like to thank our second eminent resource speaker, Honorable Guest Professor Dr. Shad Ahmad Khan, who highlighted on what is blended learning, the journey of learning, opportunity for students and teachers, challenges faced by students, teaching strategies, the conversational framework, and many more will surely create mark in our life. I would also like to thank our chief patron, Mrs. Alka Das Gupta Ji Ma'am, chairperson of BBD Group of Education, and Sir Virat Sagar Das Ji Sir, president of BBT Group of Education. I would also like to thank our patron, Professor Dr. Bhavesh Kumar Chauhan Sir, director of BBT ITM Lucknow, and our advisory professor, Dr. Manish Singh Sir, HOD of Department of Management, BBT ITM Lucknow. I would also like to thank our organizing secretary, Dr. Shivangi Tiwari Ma'am, assistant professor of Department of Management, BBT ITM Lucknow, without whom FDP cannot be possible. We will ever remain grateful to you, and we thank you for being with us every time. And I would also like to thank our student coordinators, without whom support this event would have not completed successfully. Ashna Aditi Ahmed, Mitali Kisarwani, Mansi Mohanan, Nimish Gupta, and Ritik Gupta, MBA first year, for assisting us throughout the program. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants for showing their interest in the faculty development program. Once again, thank you for all participating in today's fictive and interactive session. Participants, there is one announcement. Our feedback link has been shared in the chat box. You are requested to submit your feedback. After receiving your feedback, we will send you the assignment within an hour on your provided email address. Now, ma'am, with your and HOD sir permission, shall we wind up the session for today? Over to you, Dr. Shivangi Tiwari Ma'am.
Thank you so much, Palak. Thank you once again, Professor Shad Ahmad Khan sir, for finding time for us. It's a privilege to hear you. And thank you once again from the whole BBD EG group, sir. Director sir, with your permission, shall we wind up the session?
Ma'am, please do. Thank you.
Thank
you. And thank you, Professor Khan, once again.
Thank you, Bhatnagar, ma'am.
Thank you, Bhatnagar, ma'am. Thank you, Bhatnagar, ma'am.
Thanks a lot, sir. My pleasure.
Thank you so much, ma'am.